वेलकम एवरीवन, टुडे वी हैव विद अस रफी तरफदार, एसवीपी एंड चीफ टेक्नोलॉजी ऑफिसर ऑफ स्ट्रैटेजिक टेक्नोलॉजी ग्रुप एट इंफोसिस। वेलकम टू द शो रफी।
या थैंक्स सो मच सुनील फॉर हैविंग मी ऑन द शो।
या सो आई थिंक आई विल जंप स्ट्रेट टू द क्वेश्चंस। नाउ यू नो ऑफ कोर्स द बर्निंग इशू इज कोविड, बट यू नो व्हेन कोविड हैड कम अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल हैड थॉट इट वुड बी टेंपरेरी, बट नाउ इट हैज बिकम परमानेंट, right? So this is the new normal, this is the way we are going forward, and digital transformation is inevitable and it's going to be a top priority. So from your point of view, what are the kind of digital strategies that big companies are adopting to ensure business continuity in the future? Because we could have more pandemics, we could have more problems. So now we have are forming a permanent strategy to deal with this.
No, sure. So I think what we are finding is there are four key strategies that are very relevant in order to deal with these kind of black swan events, right, that are happening. And the first and foremost is resilience, because when COVID outbreak hit us last year, the operational resilience of the existing businesses was tested significantly, right? And resilience could mean the ability of their current infrastructure to scale, the ability of their current systems to adapt to these new normal, the ability for them to operate the business in the normal way. All of these were significantly tested. And what we saw over the last year is that organizations have started investing significantly in improving their resilience, right? And be it with respect to scale, be it with respect to availability, with respect to change, and with respect to experience. The second thing that we have also started seeing is an increased focus on cloud acceleration. So if you look at it, while everybody was already doing digital transformation and everybody was talking about digital, now we see an increased focus on cloud, right? So a lot of them have already put in a strategy to say that in the next 4 to 5 years, they want to move a large part of their existing IT estate to cloud. Now, again, here we are seeing a combination of strategies, right? So it's not just about being on a public cloud, but choosing the best of public and private clouds, but creating that cloud infrastructure that enables them to operate from anytime, anywhere. And that is what is driving a lot of this cloud acceleration. And we see a lot of work happening with our clients, with a lot of Fortune 500 organizations in this space. The third thing is on modernization. Right, because while on one hand everybody has an aspiration to move to cloud, a lot of data, a lot of applications, a lot of integration and experience that was working within their private data centers is not best suited for cloud. So there is some amount of modernization that is required. Modernization, one, to ensure they benefit from cloud. Second, also to bring in a lot of cost efficiency and cost optimization, right? Because that is the other thing that we are seeing, that organizations are trying to optimize on cost as they move to cloud and modernize. The fourth important thing that we are seeing is this whole shift towards anytime, anywhere operating model. Right? So now, in this new normal, traditionally what used to happen is for anything that has to be done, an employee would go to the organization to avail the services. And now everybody is thinking, how do we make these services available to employees, customers, partners, wherever they are, through digital tools which could run on a commoditized hardware. It could be a phone, it could be a laptop or anything. And this is not just about technology, right? What we also realized is this requires changes in policies, this requires changes in processes, and it also requires a bit of a cultural shift. And what we are now starting to see is organizations starting to think about it, and they are working on a lot of workplace transformation in order to drive these changes.
Yeah. So anyway, I think that's good to hear. Business resiliency seems to be one good thing we have, gone forward, like what you talked due to cloud privatization. And I think Infosys was at the center of the 24-hour, culture long back. So I think we can take it forward. So, but Infosys has always been at the center of action, and it has played a major role in many of these digital strategies. What specific cases or trends can you talk about with regard to the same? How has remote working adopted quickly? How has this made operations easier? Some of these points you have mentioned in the previous answer, but maybe you can take it forward.
Sure. So I think, see, at Infosys, almost about 3 years back, right, and this was the time when Nandan joined us back as the chairman of the company. Prior to that, you know, he had done a lot of work for Aadhaar, he had done a lot of work for startups. He said, we need to reimagine Infosys as a digital native company, right? And that's when we started this whole initiative we call as a live enterprise. And live enterprise is about transforming traditional enterprises to operate as digital natives. And one of the good things that Nandan also told us is that, you know, Infosys should walk the talk, and Infosys should be the company that should first transform itself to be a digital native company, right? And so in that way, almost 3 years back, we had started thinking about a lot of these things. And what happened in COVID is whatever we did was tested at scale. And the good thing is, you know, a lot of infrastructure that we have put together, a lot of work we did as part of live enterprise essentially helped us scale and adapt to this change that happened. Now, if you look at again the client transformation that we are working with our clients, we are again working with our clients in each of those four areas that we talked about, right? So one, from a resiliency standpoint, we are working with them to see how do we make their existing IT landscape itself fairly significantly resilient, bring in a lot of extreme automation, bring in a lot of AI into the way the applications and infrastructure is managed and all that. We are doing a lot of work on modernization today. So we are doing modernization for, let's say, the legacy systems like mainframes. There is a lot of work happening on modernization of ERPs as well, right? So ERPs, when how do you essentially move them to cloud, and how do you create a core around ERPs? How do you reimagine the experience? So that's the other trend that is happening. Then in terms of employee experience and workplace transformation, also we are seeing a lot of shift where now a lot of our clients are saying that they want to reimagine the employee experience, right? Because now everybody is working remotely. So the focus on employee has shifted more. See, you know, how do you make that employee experience a lot more consumer grade and make it a lot more personalized and better? So these are some areas that we are doing. And the good thing is, because we did a lot of it as part of our live enterprise transformation, we also created a lot of assets and platforms that today we are able to take and help accelerate our own clients' transformation.
Yeah. So like one thing is your journey with the clients, but then what about like Infosys itself? So, you know, like we talk of being agile. So Infosys has made itself agile and re-architected its digital infrastructure during the last few years. So maybe you could speak a bit of a detail about that.
No, absolutely. So I think as part of live enterprise over the last 3 years, we have reimagined the experience. We have reimagined a lot of business processes, and we have created a shared digital infrastructure for the company, right? Now, obviously, we did all of these with few goals, right? So one, we wanted to create the agility of a startup. We wanted to create velocity of ideas and innovation so that, you know, we can take these things faster to market, faster to our clients. We wanted to create a culture where everybody is connected and is collaborating through collaboration platforms. And we are also very responsive to a lot of customer needs. And we wanted to do all of this through a lot of sentience, right? Which is the ability for us to sense, process, and respond in real time. Now, what did we do in reimagining experience, right? So at Infosys, one, what we did is we started the reimagining of experience with learning. So first we launched an entire new learning platform called Lex. We internally call it Lex. Lex essentially is available on your phones, using which all 240,000 of our employees can learn anytime, anywhere, right? And what today we see is, on an average, about 35 minutes is the time that our employees are spending in learning new technologies. And, you know, for Infosys being in this whole tech space where technology is evolving very quickly, this has worked out very well for us. The second thing that we did is we then launched InfiMe. InfiMe is a personal productivity app, using which, you know, for example, you could apply for leave, you can check for policies, you can book your travel. Now, anyways, you don't travel, but, you know, you have those features, you can check for information, and you can also look up for your project details and everything else, right? So this is, again, something that today has been embraced by 200,000 odd users of our employees. So when we moved remote and we wanted to collect information, it became very easy because this again runs on your mobile phone, right? It be it on an Android, iOS, or any device, and it became easy. Then we said a lot of employees who are today new, you know, joinees who are joining Infosys, for them we launched a new digital platform we call Launchpad. So Launchpad, using which earlier, you know, a lot of processes were very paper driven. Everything used to be paper centric. So now everything is being done through this digital app. And today, you know, almost we have had about 30,000 plus employees who have come through this digital process. This is also helping us from a sustainability goal, right? Because we have eliminated million plus papers that we have taken. So if you look at it, now we are doing it for alumni. So we are creating a similar digital touch point for our alumni. So the entire experience from an employee joining to learning to operating to leaving is fully digitized and is fully mobile first. Now what we are doing is we are taking this to a next level where we are saying, how do we make this available to our partners and clients? And that is what we are working on right now, right? Now, if I come back to the shared digital infrastructure, we started creating platforms for the company on which the whole company could run. The first thing we did is, you know, we created this Polycloud platform. So if you look at today, the reality is every business today is operating across multiple clouds. So they are operating across multiple public clouds and maybe more than one private cloud. Now, the landscape has become complex. So how do you operate and manage across this large cloud footprint? And this is where the Polycloud platform helps us provision an environment, deploy applications, manage across any of the cloud. Then we said, you know, we wanted to democratize AI, because what we believe is this decade is all about AI. And if Infosys has to be at the forefront of AI, then every employee has to have access to the AI infrastructure. So we have worked with NVIDIA and we have created an AI cloud. And the idea again with AI cloud is to bring the best of AI infrastructure that is required for any of our employees to do rapid experimentations and pilots and create those AI services. Then we are now working on creating marketplace where we are curating and bringing all our IP together, so that this IP is something that we can use in order to drive hyper-productivity. And we are also creating platforms like, you know, we have Leap, we have CyberNet, Cortex 2, a whole lot of these things which are coming out of our own evolution, which are helping us run our business better, right? So in that way, if you look at it across each of those layers, there is a lot of reimagination that has happened.
Okay. So I think we've covered a lot of changes in the pre-COVID and post-COVID era. So probably I'll ask one last question. What do you expect will be the top tech trends of the decade 2020s? So can you talk in detail about some of them? They could be short-term, long-term, or both.
Sure. So I think if you look at the entire, last decade, I'll start with AI as the first macro trend, right? So the way we look at it is we see 9 macro trends that we believe will be very relevant for this decade. Last decade was all about AI in consumer tech space, right? So AI was very, and AI today is part of our lives thanks to the work done by Google, by Microsoft, by Amazon, and Apple, and all of them. This decade, we believe, will be the decade where AI will reach the second inflection point and it will move into enterprise space. We will, right now what we see is a lot of work that is happening in AI is still in the enterprise space, is mostly in pilots and innovations. And we are starting to see some early success. We are starting to see some projects go into production. But as, you know, the AI infrastructure gets more commoditized, as the availability of data becomes more common for AI training, we will see that AI will become core to everything we do in this decade. And this requires a different approach, which is where you know, you need the ability to discover, democratize, and de-risk, which will be the big thing from an AI standpoint. The second macro trend we see from a cloud standpoint is every enterprise will operate across multiple clouds. And you know, this is what we call as polycloud. So polycloud will become a trend. And Kubernetes will become the new middleware, right? So today what's happening is now with a lot of this multi-cloud scenarios, Kubernetes will become the new middleware on which all of your application development and microservices and everything will become the norm. So containers and Kubernetes will be the big thing where a lot of these innovations will start happening. The third thing, if you now look at it from an experience standpoint, you know, a lot of earlier decades were all about keyboards, were about, you know, then when the whole mobile era came, it was all about touch. This decade will be also about natural and adaptive experience, right? So what started with Alexa, where, you know, with voice, you are able to do a lot of stuff. Somewhere in this decade, with some, you know, we are already seeing a lot of advancements in augmented reality now. Mixed reality might become the norm. Eyewears are going to come. Wearables will become more common. So a lot of our experience will become a lot more natural the way we do with each other. But this does not mean that we will move away from the touch and, you know, from the mouse and clicks. The natural interface will start supplementing and taking away some of those experiences onto those new mediums, right? The fourth thing is around data. I think data, you know, if you look at any AI projects, 60 to 70% of the time actually goes in data preparation and in data labeling. And, you know, while everybody talks about AI, a lot of them underestimate the effort that goes in data preparation. So I think a lot of work will also be done on connecting data, on creating a connected data ecosystem. And this is where a lot of new things are happening in database space. Like, for example, you're seeing a lot of graph databases, you are seeing online analytical databases, you are seeing you know, the emergence of a lot of tools which are used in order to make the entire data streaming, data processing a lot more real time. So a lot of these will essentially allow us to create a new data foundation which is a lot more connected, which will also become a foundation for us to drive the whole AI evolution that we're looking at it for this decade. The next thing will be more on the API side, right? So while APIs and things are something that we've been talking about, but what we see this decade will also be that a lot of APIs will also become, especially for enterprises, I think they will have to now get into this space where APIs have to be made available to create a developer ecosystem. Because, you know, as businesses move from B2B to B2B2C or B2C, if they want to create layered innovation powered by fintechs, then they need to create a vibrant developer ecosystem, which means the APIs that their enterprise business provides have to be made available to the business in order to operate and do a lot of this stuff, right? So that will become very important. Then the other thing that we're also seeing is data, you know, a lot of engineering excellence that was happening through DevSecOps is now moving towards DevSecOps, right? So how do you bring security and privacy into everything we do? Because as the footprint has increased across the cloud, as the threat surface has increased, security and privacy first have become very important. So DevSecOps itself is now making that shift left, where a lot of your security checks, your privacy checks are done upfront. And that is creating a new norm. Now, the other thing that is happening is with the emergence of these low-code, no-code platforms, the citizens developers are becoming a lot more dominant now, right? And today there are a lot of these low-code, no-code tools provided by cloud providers, by the likes of Appian, Node Systems, and others. And this is helping move from the shadow IT that most of the organizations have into better governed platforms, using which a lot of quick, rapid experimentation and innovation and prototyping could be done, right? And that is again something that we're seeing driving adoption. The other last two macro trends we see is cybersecurity is now becoming mainstream, Because what's happened is, you know, till now cybersecurity used to be somewhere on the sides, focused on by security teams. But today, as the footprint has increased significantly and as the entire the threat surface has increased, cybersecurity has become the norm and it has become mainstream. So in everything that we do, everybody is focused on cybersecurity. And the last one is on operational resilience, right? So how do you bring operational resilience through platforms where you have observability at scale, where you know you are bringing in AI ops capabilities in order to manage the entire operations better, where you become more business centric, business KPI centric, process centric. So that is the other big shift that is happening in operations, to bring a lot of resilience, a lot of extreme automation and a lot of intelligence to turn enterprises into autonomous enterprises, right? Where a lot of these routine decisions can be done in an automated way. So these are the nine big macro trends that we are seeing relevant for this immediate few years as well as for this decade.
So I think that's a very comprehensive roadmap for the future. And I'm sure 2020s will be quite exciting for India and the world. So
absolutely.
I think, So I think any last point you'd like to add before we end the interview? Because I think those nine points have basically covered up everything what we can look forward to.
Yeah, no, I think I would say this is the, you know, very exciting time to be in technology space. And I think this decade will be an exponential decade as well. And for India as well, I think it is an exponential decade. So I think if we leverage a lot of these technologies, build platforms for scale and create solutions that make a difference, then I think we can make a big change.
Yeah. Okay. So on that positive note, I think we'll end this interview. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you so much, sir. Thanks.
Yeah.